Thank you all so much for being here. This is a really exciting opportunity for us at the Barbershop Harmony Society to elevate voices in our barbershop community. And this is actually the first inclusion in barbershop series that we're doing. And this is the first one of those series. So these are these lovely people are kind of our test subjects for the inclusion in barbershop series. So if there are any kind of quirks or things here that are kinks that need to be worked out, I apologize for that. We're still kind of learning on this side as well. We're so grateful to present today for giving their time, all of our presenters for giving their time and their energy toward this panel discussion for you. As a thank you for their volunteered time, and if you would like to see more content like this that's accessible, because this is a free event, if you would like to consider donating $5 so we can continue to make wonderful, accessible content like this, we'll put that link in the chat for you. But again, it's not required. This is a free event. That's only if you're feeling so inclined to do so. Again, after the webinar, there will be an unrecorded Q&A session. You can register for that there or in the chat, because Journey is going to put a link to that Q&A in the chat. And we'll include it again several times throughout and also at the end of the webinar as well. There will be a short survey after this webinar. It's anonymous, so there's no way we can track you down and get back to you about your what you include in your survey unless you want to put your name to it so we can contact you later. But you can include anything that you want to give us in terms of feedback, tell us how you liked the event, what were some big takeaways. And there's just, it's about 5 questions long. It'll take you less than a minute and a half to complete. So if you wouldn't mind filling out that survey afterward, we would be so gracious. Again, just as a general disclaimer, these folks have been asked to be on this panel to represent a wide array of identities within the Barbershop Harmony Society, but they can only represent their own personal perspectives and points of view. They are the LGBTQ plus community, as well as various gender identities throughout Barbershop, is a huge community to represent, but these folks are here to only talk from their experiences, their thoughts, their feelings, their backgrounds, and that's what we've asked them to do. So we think that representation matters, and storytelling is a powerful teaching tool. Our hope is that you walk away with more education about the barriers to inclusion in the barbershop community that we face, and more information to assist you in your own self-inquiry and assessment and audit of your own practices in your ensemble, your chorus, or even your personal life. They, however, can only represent themselves, like I said, and the challenges do not portray all the thoughts and feelings of an entire community. So just keep that in mind as we're going throughout. We do also have a definition sheet. You might hear some words throughout the course of this webinar that you might be unfamiliar with. Journey will post a link to that, and Alex will go over a couple of those briefly before we get into this. But this is not an informational course on the LGBTQ plus theory or gender identity theory or anything like that. If you would like specifically more information on definitions and some of that, you should check out Alex Morris's class on education.barbershop.org. It's called Working with Diverse Voices, and it's awesome. So now I'm going to briefly introduce our lovely moderator, Terry Reynolds. Terry has been a member of the Alexandria Harmonizers since 1992. And has served in numerous musical and leadership positions, including the executive director, president, and music and performance VP. He has an associate and assistant director for over 20 years. He has held numerous positions within the Barbershop Harmony Society, serving on the Leadership Operations Project Team, or LOPT, Chorus Director Development Committee as a certified trainer for a Chorus Director Workshop Intensive, and on the Leadership Academy Training Faculty for Music and Performance. So literally, this man has done everything, which is why he is the best person we could think of to moderate this. And I hope you enjoy this panel. Journey and myself will join again briefly at the end just to give some closing statements. And then I hope you take it away. Thanks, Terry.
All right. Thank you so much, Journey and Ashley, and thanks not only for that nice setup, but for making this all happen and for hosting this great series. I know we're all excited to be part of it, and I hope there will be more of it in the future. So we're going to take a few minutes to let the panelists introduce ourselves, but before we do that, Alex, would you give us some terminology that might be useful in this evening's events?
Absolutely. Thank you, Terry. So you'll get the definition sheet, which has been put together with a range of different terms that as a panel, we thought would be very important to share with you, but also to give you a little bit more scope when we're having discussions today during this panel. I thought I'd just take a couple of minutes really quickly to unpack a couple of those things before we get started. The first thing I want to say is that none of what we're going to talk about today is necessarily new. The spectrum of gender and sex and sexuality is biologically ingrained in us as human beings. But we've only really recently figured out how to define it all and understand it using our own language, which is why it kind of feels new for a lot of us. In truth, it's been part of us since the beginning of time. So this presentation is going to cover probably a lot of things that people haven't heard before, but possibly a lot of things that they have heard before, but a couple to really unpack really quickly at the beginning. I'd like to remind everyone of something that I find very important to remind myself of when talking about this topic, that the word sex does not always inform the word gender, and the word gender doesn't always inform the word sexuality. To quickly identify what those three things are, sex is the difference between male and female sexes and anatomical physiology. Sex tends to relate to biological differences. Gender more relates to an understanding of self and gender identity and an internal sense of masculinity or femininity of neither of those two. Finally, sexuality is often referred to as someone's orientation or their psycho-emotional physical affiliations. And it's in relation to which genders they are attracted to or not attracted to. So a reminder that sex doesn't always inform gender, and gender doesn't always inform sexuality. The last two little points I want to make before we get started are that it's okay to have questions. We all have questions, and learning is such an important thing for us to do in this area. And the final thing to remind yourselves of is it's okay to make mistakes. We all make mistakes in every aspect of our life from time to time. And a topic like this, which for some of us is a new and a jump in the deep end, it's totally okay to make mistakes. In fact, the fact that you're all here is such a brilliant thing. So never beat yourself up for making mistakes or asking questions, because that's why this community is so important to provide this information for you. So thanks so much, everyone. Back to Terry.
All right. Thanks, Alex. Well, I'm going to pass it back to you pretty quickly, but just so everybody knows who we are and why we're on the panel and how we identify, just let everybody do quick introductions of ourselves. We'll talk as a group in a bit more about early life, but if you would each give, include, we've got our pronouns on the screen, but if you want to talk about that more, your geographic region through your life and your how you identify yourself. Let's go back to you, Alex.
Well, hello, thank you very much, Terry. My name is Alex Morris. My pronouns are he and him. I live in Melbourne in Victoria, down in Australia. However, I have been very involved with the BHS as a judge and educator for the last few years. I'm pansexual, and if anyone wants a definition of that, please let me know. I'm really pleased to be on this panel. I've been doing some work for the BHS over the last couple of years around inclusion and diversity in this topic. It's something that I feel very passionately about and something that I'm very much involved in down here in Australia. So I'm very excited to bring my experience and my knowledge to this panel and to the greater Barbershop community as well. Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks, Alex. Mo Field.
Yeah. Hi, everybody. I'm Mo Field. I'm she, her. Just the way that is, I kind of let it land with my with the sex that I was born with, although my gender identity is very much non-binary or gender neutral or queer, gender queer. We'll get into all of that, I'm sure, in some time. I'm from Toronto right now, in Toronto, Ontario. I'm Canadian. I've been living in Sweden for 14 years before I moved back to Canada. So I very much identify with Barbershop in Europe as well as in North America. I'm a BHS judge in the performance category. I serve at the BHS on the strategic planning committee. I'm a director of Great Northern Union. I'm the previous director of Stockholm City Voices, a Sweet Adeline chorus. I've been very active in gay rights most of my life in the queer community and the LGBTQ community as it's grown in its own definition over time. I mean, it's really evolved, since back in the day when it, like, I cannot believe we're having this panel. This is so awesome.
When I met you in the Rainbow Suite some probably 20 years ago, this would have been hard to imagine.
I know, right? I know. Here we are now. Look at us, high atop. So this is pretty cool that everybody's come and so many people so interested in this. you know, I've been a musician all my life. My family are musicians. It's just music, 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 music. I've tried to do other things, but they didn't take. I'm destined to earn hundreds of dollars a year. It's just the way it is. It's just great to be amongst people. I love people connecting with other people, and that folks are folks. I get to travel the world as a coach, as a barbershop coach. That's actually, you know, where I met actually Alex for the first time was down in Australia. So that's pretty cool. And getting to connect with a bunch of people. I'm also very out when I coach, and I've had a lot of people come and tell their stories to me about, you know, you're the first person I've been able to be honest about this with and blah, blah, blah. So there's a huge need for discussion and discourse around this. And I'm so happy to be on this panel tonight. And thank you for inviting me. And thanks to Journey and Ashley for putting this all together.
Thanks, Mo. Baz. Baz or Mia?
That's actually on purpose. So when I picked my name, my dead name is not that far off from what you see on the screen. It's been modified a bit, but I realized that some people called me Mia and some people called me Baz. So I actually chose Andor as a really funny middle name because I thought it was hilarious and it was totally appropriate. I find that people tend to get the pronouns right if they don't know me as well if they use Baz. It seems to be, Mia still seems a bit feminine, but my pronouns are they, them, theirs. I am in Brooklyn, living in the hot spot, so aptly named. I live with my quartet, Hot Second. We are members of the Mid-Atlantic District Opera Second Row. Thank you, roommates. And other Gothamites. We have plenty of Gothamites in the participant list today, attendant list today. I am a member of Sirens and also the SATB ensemble that Gotham has been cooking up, yet to be named because we're going to make our debut, but we had this pandemic raging outside. So that's on hold for now. I would be in Voices of Gotham were it not for the fact that time turners aren't really a thing and they rehearse at the same time as Sirens. Otherwise, you know, we'd have that worked out. That's a bunch of things. I grew up on Long Island. We'll talk about other history things later. I'm just really excited to be here. Mo was talking about how she's very out and likes to talk to people about their experiences. You're kind of like, you're a beacon of light for me, Mo. The first time you came to coach Sirens, it was like I hadn't talked to you yet, but I finally saw somebody who looked like me in the way like your aura was just like, yeah, I am this flavor of queer. And I'm like, oh, this resonates. I can talk to you. And it really impacted me. And shout out to all of my sweet Adeline friends. I think I ended up here because somewhere a couple of years ago after I came out, and if you'd read my blog, you've gotten the story, but TLDR, I screamed into the sweet Adeline's chat void. I'm like, anybody out here not a woman? And the conversation has grown from there. So I'm happy to be here. I'm glad that, oh, hello, friends. I see you. Thank you. It's for you that I'm here.
Awesome. Any other parts of your identity that you want to
oh, yeah. Yeah, sorry, my sexuality. That was a journey, but I landed on demi-pansexual, which is, Alex, here. Guess we're going to have that definition real quick. It means that gender is irrelevant to who I find myself attracted to, but that attraction won't happen unless there's a deep emotional connection. So,
awesome. Ta-da. All right, Steve Scott.
Hello, friends. Happy to be with you here this evening or this morning, depending on where you are. Steve, I work for the Barbershop Harmony Society. I'm he, him. I am a heterosexual, and I am a longtime voice teacher, and I am on this panel because when Ashley and Journey were putting this thing together, I'm like, I'd be happy to jump on and talk about like the biophysiology of anything that's going on, because I know that especially in barbershop, there's this conception about singing and who should be singing and only so-and-sos can sing. And I just want to be able to speak to that specifically. I've been a barbershopper for 30 years and love this group. And I'm so happy that we're having this conversation tonight.
Awesome. Thanks and welcome aboard. Ashley gave a pretty long introduction for me, but I am a gay man, cisgendered, he, him. I grew up in rural Ohio in the 70s when I didn't know really what gay was. There wasn't much out there, but luckily I found some later. Moved to Washington, D.C. out of college and lived my entire adult life here. Another identity I just wanted to throw out there is I'm HIV positive. I was diagnosed in 1995 when there was reason to hide it. There really isn't any reason to hide it anymore, but there hasn't been much of a reason to, you know, unless if you're not my doctor or my dentist or on a date with me, there's no reason that you need to know. But in terms of intersectionality and discussion this evening, I thought I would state that out there as well. Are there any other identities that other panelists want to come out of the closet about before we move forward? Alex, you've got to hear something.
I'm a big fan of Terry Reynolds.
Boy.
Put it out there publicly.
Yeah, I want to check that. Big fan. I just want Terry to read me the phone book and I'll be happy. Other than that, I'm a lesbian.
I struggle with mental health, but I'm working super hard with a care team and a really good support system. So awesome. Let's destigmatize that. And happy National Coming Out Day.
Yes, thank you. I meant to mention that earlier. Thank you for
catching
that.
Great scheduling, BHS. Excellent. Really nailed it.
I'll also come out about something else. I'm on the autism spectrum.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I am. I know. There you go. It's there.
Boom. Boy, it's all pouring out now anymore. All right. So I thought I'd go a little bit, give you a little idea of how we're going to spend the next a little over an hour now. We're going to spend some time getting to know the panelists in a little more detail. We're going to, not going to individually, but collectively talk about our early life and how we got into barbershop. Then we're going to talk about some obstacles that we've experienced. We talked about the storytelling, obstacles that we've experienced in our barbershop life in terms of macroaggressions and microaggressions that have made it harder for us to be comfortable in who we are in barbershop. And share that. We are going to talk about transitioning voices with Steve and Alex's experience in that as well, and Baz certainly. And then we're going to wrap up by talking on the more positive side, the inclusion in barbershop, what things are going on and things that we can recommend to each other to help keep that inclusion being more positive going forward. So group, let's talk about our early life non-barbershop, individual music backgrounds, cultural backgrounds. Who wants to start? Mo, you're on mute.
I am not on mute. Okay. Early background. Again, born into a musical family. My mother was a concert pianist. I thought everybody's mother just bashed off Rachmaninoff every day. I thought it was a normal thing. I've never known life without music ever. So it's been my solace in many, many ways. It's also been a gateway for me to be able to express myself. As we grow, we realize how much more of ourselves we need to express. We don't really know from the beginning. We're just, you know, going along. But as we mature, especially when it comes to, you know, especially around puberty, I think I knew I was different, you know, all my life. That was for sure. I wasn't like the other girls. And I did know that. I grew up in a time where, you know, I had to kind of hide culturally, I had to hide who I was. I was teased for being gay before I had even really identified it. And it was actually through that teasing that I started thinking about it. And I realized people are seeing something in me that I didn't even know how to identify in myself. Which was pretty amazing, actually, you know, even though it was complete bullying, it was also very eye-opening, and it gave me, it sent me, like, driving me right into the closet through high school, but I got questioned a lot, and then, it, you know, I just could not take it. It was a pressure cooker for me, and I ended up having to just, like, I didn't come out of the closet. I literally kicked the door down.
At what age?
On my exit, I was 19 officially, although, you know, the teasing started when I was probably 11 or 10 or 11. And I knew, but I was raised in a fairly, well, we weren't a very religious household, but culturally, you know, the culture of the religion that I was raised in was, it was definitely a no-no to be gay. And in a small Mennonite town, you just, you know, there was nobody to talk to. There were no other than the woman that I thought might be gay on the basketball team, there wasn't really anybody to talk to. You know, that's not really like big encouragement to you know, confess, or there's just no support network. There was just no support network. Again, why dialogue is so incredibly important, and panels like this endlessly happening are so incredibly important. I found Barbershop also when I was 19, walked into a pizza parlor, was singing a musical, walked into a pizza parlor, heard this table burst into song, went over, they asked the question, can you sing? Because that's the question you ask. They, of course. You know, fresh meat, that's all they're thinking. You sing a tag, the next thing you know, you're in a chorus, and 20 years have gone by, and you've made some of the best friendships that you'll ever make in your entire lifetime. And so that's kind of it for Barbershop. It's taken me everywhere. Why did it stick with me? Why did Barbershop
let's hold off the getting into, let's spend a little more time with everyone on our own backgrounds, and then we'll get into more into the getting into Barbershop.
You can see, I'm a bass player. I'm a guitar player. I'm a songwriter. I've been in a bazillion musicals. I've played French horn orchestrally. I'm a multi-instrumentalist. I'm an arranger. I've had a publishing contract, writing music for film, TV, other artists, myself. I've toured extensively. But Barbershop. It's the people. It's the harmony. It's the negotiation of coordination of something bigger than ourselves that really thrills me. The music industry did not. Even though I love writing music, I've recorded, I love being in the studio, I love producing, I love all of that work, but actually I just really like music and people.
Awesome. And it doesn't have to be one at a time. We can jump in on each other's. Alex, let's start with your musical, cultural coming out background.
Absolutely. Well, I grew up in Perth, Western Australia. For those that don't know, Perth is regarded as the most isolated city in the world geographically. It's still a pretty big place, but in terms of major cities close by, there's not many. I grew up in a family with my brother and my half-sister, who was around every now and then. Went to a United Church school that was very supportive of music. I started playing violin when I was age 6 and played all the way through until I went to university. And during school, sang in like every choir possible to me, was in musicals, did all that kind of stuff, was music captain, classic music nerd, you know, the way it is. But it was a time when I discovered that I wanted to spend a lot of my time doing music. I also grew up in a fairly religious family. In fact, my dad was trained to be a priest. Having never gone to church when I was a kid, he decided he would become a priest halfway through my adolescence, and I was always very confused and surprised about that. Never finished it, but he and I often would do a lot of work with the church together, and used to go away and preach and write songs for our worship band at church. And then I went to university and started to question my faith. Around this time, I probably started to question my sexuality. But growing up in my church, it was kind of cool. We had an openly gay priest from when I was quite young, so there was never any of that stigmatism in the church for me around homosexuality, which was a very different experience to a lot of other people, I think. I came out, I guess, officially like in my late teens, but had to do it again to my parents when I said, actually, I have a boyfriend now, not just this word I was using to describe myself. So that was when I was at university studying classical music. I originally auditioned on violin, but sucked. So decided to wait a year and auditioned on voice and composition and did a composition degree. And have worked since then writing and arranging pretty extensively across genres. I had this big lofty dream of becoming the next big thing in Australian classical composition. But then I really sunk my teeth into this Barbershop thing and realized that my skills and my time was much better suited to an organization that allowed me to work with people and work with everyday people who had a passion for singing, just like I did. As I got a bit older, my queer life started to, I guess, dominate more of what I do. I conduct a couple of choirs here in Melbourne now. One of them's the Gay and Lesbian Youth Chorus, which exists in Melbourne. And I found myself in the last couple of years doing a lot more work as a queer performance artist. I'm a drag queen, go figure. Do a lot of work making queer theatre for young people, kids, all the way through to adults. I realized last year or the year before that my musical life and my queer life were kind of very separate. So only in my very early 30s have I realized that those two things can coexist together in a world where I can create queer art for everyone. My experience has been of a pretty inclusive nature, but it doesn't mean it hasn't been rocky, but I think I've had a pretty I've had a pretty good time and I've had a pretty lucky time. And I'm very proud that I'm able to do the work I do across generations and across genres, both incorporating my musical history, but also my queer history as well.
Awesome. Mia.
Aha. Yes, Mia. See, it could go either way. It's so flexible. That was like the first, one of the first things I made known was that, like, my name was Mia, not the birth name that I was given. My grandfather called me that. We lived on Long Island. It was me, my sister, two parents, my grandfather. And it was, knowing myself was not a priority, unfortunately. I think that's the most diplomatic way to say it. But I started singing very early, and I kind of picked up instruments along the way. Like, you know, you start an instrument in fourth grade. So I picked up the flute, and then I picked up the piccolo, and then I'm like saxophones. And I just focused on all of those things. And outside of home, my biggest support were my teachers. And home is not a very big support. So it wasn't a very far leap. I spent a lot of time doing as many musical things as I could, and they really inspired me to want to reach out and help people and do this music thing at the same time. And just knowing the impact they had on me, I'm like, yeah, this makes sense. So I went to Queens College for initially music education, took my first theory class, and I'm like, actually, I really want to invest some time in this theory thing. I trust my ability to talk to people and relate to them. So why don't I go off on this branch and sang the whole way. And while I love me some Palestrina and Joscan, hearing that first Barbershop tag was amazing. Later, I know. But in the meantime, I had spent all of this time focusing on the things I could do to get me to a safe place and to do the things that I love, that it didn't occur to me for a really long time that I might want to reflect on who I might be attracted to, because I started working at a job, it was Starbucks, and they were all like, oh, you might be a lesbian. And I'm like, no way. So I cut my hair super short and I still didn't believe it. And it took me another year to figure it out. And it really, I had to get myself to a place where I could be like, okay, like, I'm going to start observing my thoughts. Not just in terms of what I think about the outside world, but what I think about myself, like, who am I? And as I got to know myself, I'm like, oh, okay, cool. So I'm gay, I guess. Men weren't doing it for me at the time. So I'm like, okay, this must be it, right? This is easy, done. Started hosting karaoke at a lesbian bar, which was a ton of fun. And along the way, I met people who would eventually land me in a barbershop circle, just through where they worked. By the time I had gotten there, I'm like, oh, like, I've been doing this karaoke thing, and I've been in this community. It doesn't quite fit. It still wasn't the scene I really wanted. Something felt really unsettled about myself, but no bother. I have to go. I need a chorus again. I can't exist without a chorus, apparently. There's just something to it. It took me a long time to come to who I was, but music has kind of carried me the whole way. And I think that I really came of age in my personal identity after I joined. So I want to give some space to the rest of our early life stories, and then we'll get into the barbershop.
So just real quick, would you find your self-discovery of sexuality and gender were all together, or did they happen separately, or?
They were really intertwined for me. And I think it's just because it took me so long to figure out who I was for, you know, one chaotic life reason after another, which I think a lot of people experience. And without getting the opportunity to really get to know yourself, it can be hard to, right. like Mo was saying, like, you don't necessarily know how much you need to express yourself when you start doing it. So if you don't get there for a while, it's just like, oh, wow, there's all these things to me that I had no idea. And I think having the right community and support is what really fueled that. And that's when I started getting, like, loud. Because I had things to say. I had, you know, there were people out there like me who couldn't say them. So I had to start saying them.
Yeah. And
here we are.
And the once you actually feel comfortable saying them, the the weight lifted is something that is
it's phenomenal.
Understand. Yeah.
And all I want to do is just lift that weight off of as many people as I can.
Awesome. All right, Steve Scott, you have a different experience than the rest of us, but in the
it's less
pan of of this panel, please tell us your background.
It's less of a journey that I think than others. I mean, my parents found out that I was a heterosexual when I took a girl to prom. It's not really changed my whole life. I just have been around barbershoppers and singers and musicians my whole life. My dad's been an avocational singer his whole life. He sang in these big chorales in Los Angeles. And then when we moved to Southern Utah, sang in a civic chorale there, and his friends introduced him to barbershop. He's like, I'm not gonna do that. And then he went to it and loved it immediately. And I was always involved in barbershop as young as I can remember. So in terms of, I guess just my being involved in the community, I feel like I've always been an ally. I'm an educator. And so I've always felt like I've been somebody that others can talk to. And I do as much as I can to promote my fellow musicians and teachers. If you don't mind me saying one time, one of the things that I've been involved in at the BHS is Harmon University, and it's teaching at Harmon University, but then also as an employee selecting the faculty that teaches at Harmon University and what they teach and how they teach and all that stuff. And one of the things that I was involved with was setting up our morning sessions where we have physical warm-ups, mental warm-ups, conducting, all that kind of stuff. And I overheard Mo talking to a friend of ours named Sai, and just saying, Sai, do you realize that most of the people that are doing the warm-ups today are LGBTQ? And I was like, I just picked the best people for the job. I wasn't trying to be political or apolitical about it, but they were celebrating for themselves. I was like, I did that on accident, but kind of on purpose, but on accident, yay, yeah. So. Ever since then, Mo pointing it out, I've tried to be a little bit more purposeful in including folks.
Thank you. All, so. Anything else? Musical background? I guess you covered that.
You want me to talk about musical background?
Yeah, sure. Real quick.
I've been a barbershopper for 30 years. Did the choir thing all the way through middle school and high school. Thought I wanted to be a high school choir teacher when I was in college, and then quickly discovered that I didn't want to do that. I have been a college instructor for the last, 10 years or so, traveling voice coach, voice teacher. Been fortunate to give talks in New Zealand and Australia and Sweden and Germany and Holland and Portugal and the UK, all about barbershop and singing and physiology of singing. And it's been a wonderful blessing in my life. Let's see. Working on a PhD, Chelsea, still not done. Thanks for rubbing it in. I actually, right now, due to interesting circumstances of economy, I'm also, in addition to being an employee of the Barbershop Harmony Society, I'm a middle school choir teacher, something I never thought I would be doing, but it's been interesting and fun, and actually, yeah, interesting and fun. So
more power to you. I don't think I could do that, but it's so important. My music school teacher was very important to me. So good on you for doing that. I'll just add a couple of my own. Being older than much of this group and growing up in the 70s in small town Ohio, yeah, I kind of knew in puberty, but I was in college before I even started to accept it myself, and I was in a quartet with a bisexual who opened the conversation with me that let me think about it. But even after that, and I had a few relationships at the end of college when I was going to move to Washington, D.C. and get a job and in the business world, I assumed I was going to, once I made money, I was going to find a psychiatrist that would fix me. And luckily, before I had enough money to do that, I found some gay friends who helped me understand that there are gay people out there even in the 1980s, that were happy with themselves and could be open about it. I joined a small chorus called the Arlingtones and was their director for a few years and didn't feel comfortable coming out to them. I have a feeling they would have been fine with it, but I wasn't comfortable. It was one of my first big coming out moments was when I left them, when I finally stepped down as director and went on to another chorus, I put the pink triangle on the bumper of my car. That was my big coming out. And just finding the Rainbow Room at International a few years into Barbershop, that was a big part of my coming out process. I love Barbershop and I was starting to accept myself and to find that many other people that shared both those things was a big part of my coming out. Let's shift gears. Some of us talked a little bit, but just a few minutes on what got us into Barbershop and why we love it and our community and why we do it. Have anything to add if you haven't already covered it? Just jump in. All right, I'll call on you, Alex. Alex being shy, mark it on the calendar.
It's never happened, never will. Barbershop. Well, it's very different, I think, down here in Australia, the Barbershop community than in North America. And I'm sure it's a similar experience for other affiliates around the world. The singing culture in Australia is very much not like that of North America. We don't have choir teachers in schools. Lots of schools have choirs, but there's no dedicated choral program really in any school. A couple of them do, but most don't. So I was lucky to be at a school that, you know, really encouraged choral singing. Towards the end of my high school years, the local chorus director from our chorus in Perth Vocal Evolution, they started working with an all male group of singers we had at school. And it made sense for us to be doing Barbershop because it was single gender voices. So we got into Barbershop then. Then basically when all of the guys in that left school, we all ended up joining the local chorus, and all of a sudden the average age of that chorus probably went from about 60 to 30 in a matter of weeks, I think. We had a lot of fun. I had already kind of had a glimpse at what the Barbershop community was like going to a national convention in 2003, my very first one. Then as a real barbershopper in 2005, I'd been in the chorus for a couple of years, and because I was studying music, the music leadership were keen to get me involved, so started doing a bit of arranging, started as baritone section leader, and then was assistant director, and then a year later became music director of the chorus, and then a year after that, took them to their first gold medal in Australia. So it was a very rapid progression, but I think it's because I really found something that I was A, in love with, but also B, felt like I was contributing to, and that I had something to, I guess, bring to the table in this world. And I guess from there, I got hooked because as soon as people knew who I was, they were like, hey, we need to get that guy to come and work with us. And my crazy coaching schedule in Australia started. I became a music judge, and again, that hooked me even deeper. Then I became a music judge with the BHS and started teaching and judging all over the world, and was like, okay, I guess I'm in this thing for the long haul. But I guess for me, I had an interesting time because just as Mo and Terry said, you know, even 10 years ago when they first met, they didn't think this something like this would happen. Even me, only being around, you know, less time than that, I'm still floored and so honored and happy that we're getting to have these conversations. Giving my class, working with diverse voices 2 years ago at HU was a huge moment for me personally, but I think a really exciting moment for me as a member of the BHS, in that I had come into this organization as a little queer boy from Australia, and being entrusted with this information and I guess this journey. I was told when I first became a judge that I really needed to watch what I said around being a queer person, not by other judges, not by the judging community, but by other people.
other queer people or other?
Yeah, other queer people. Yeah. I made the decision there and then that I would never change who I was fundamentally. I would just recognize that in certain circumstances, I wouldn't say certain things, just like we all wouldn't say certain things in certain circumstances. I really feel like that's been a triumph for me in most of my life, is I mean, I'm very privileged to get to be who I am all the time, absolutely. But I feel like that's been a really important part of my journey, is to accept that I am who I am, and I will not change that. I will just ensure that around any company, I'm respectful of that situation. But to talk to the Rainbow Room really quickly, I came to my first international in 2010. And until this year, when COVID hit, I had been to everyone since then. It had become my yearly calendar event. Now one of four trips I usually make to North America every year. But I found the Rainbow Room, I think in 2011 was my first time. And as Terry said, that community provided me with a space that I never knew, which was this queer group of people in music. And I am so proud and so lucky that I get to call so many of those Rainbow Room guys friends. I've been going up there for now for 10 years. Now I get to host on Saturday nights. It's really
That's
fun.
Right.
And I,
And for anyone online that we'll talk a little more about the Rainbow Room for if there's people online that don't know what that is later. But I do want to move on a little bit of lightning around for the rest of, why Barbershop? Why does Barbershop an important part of your life, Mo? But you have to come off mute.
I just did. I keep doing that, but it doesn't function. Okay. Yeah. I think why Barbershop for me, it really comes down to people. You know, when I first joined, again, I was told by people to just downplay any differences that might occur, like just downplay it. And especially like the organization that I came into back then, Sweet Adelines, was a different climate than it is becoming now, thankfully. But like most barbershop back in that day, like I joined in the 80s, in the mid 80s. I was a teenager and I joined Barbershop. And I determined to myself right away, I did not understand why it would have been a problem. I thought we were here to sing. And as a matter of fact, when people kept coming forward, and we'll probably talk about, you know, the obstacles later, so I won't get into it
soon.
But I'll get into it later. But why Barbershop? A couple of years after I joined Barbershop, my mother died of cancer. And I have to tell you that the women that I was surrounded by really raised me. They really provided a family for me when I didn't really have a sense of family. And that, I think, coupled together with the making of Harmony. And when we got down to the brass tacks of it all, you know, it ended up being about really connecting with people, like really connecting with people, not just singing a tag together. Oh, isn't that great? We can sing in harmony. We could all be different and sing in harmony. And then nothing else matters. That's not necessarily true. These women knew who I was. And, you know, I'm sure for them in that day, it was as much of an effort for them to embrace me or embrace the differences about me from them I didn't really even think twice about it. I just liked them as people. I didn't really have a filter about, you know, everybody's fine for me unless they misbehave and then I question them. But until then, they were just lovely human beings and we just had a lot of love for one another and we made really great music together. And I got to explore some of the greatest friendships of my life that endure to this day. And the more I come in contact with people that sing harmony, I realize that there's a meta harmony that we're working on here. And I think the secret to Barbershop is actually at its core, when we start really voicing the intersectionality of what harmony really is on all levels, we really can, Barbershop is a tremendous tool to heal, to bind, and to create an opportunity for uniqueness within that connection. So I'm completely dedicated to the practitioners of Barbershop at whatever level. You know, it's the will to find harmony with another person. And I'm not just talking metaphorically. I'm not just talking about we locked a chord today. No, you can lock chords and still not make harmony. You're just like in line. That's not the same as harmony. So there's this other beauty that I seek and I find it here.
Awesome. Thank you. Mia, why Barbershop?
Ugh, why do I have to follow up Mofield? Plus one to like all of that. But in all seriousness, it's like, I find that a lot of people have the same, you know, category of response. Like I came for the ringing sevens, but I stayed for the people. But it's so true. It's so true. And I think what what made it stick for me is I still don't know who I am, but I really didn't know who I was even by the time I joined Sirens. And it was always a space. It was always a brave space. I like saying brave space instead of space, safe space, because no, everybody makes mistakes. It's human. We were talking about that before. Like, but they're committed to making me feel like I belong, like everybody belongs. And it's just been that way from the start. So when I finally got comfortable enough to start connecting with other people outside of our Gotham community and more into, I mean, I started in SAI. I'm sorry, still cutting my teeth on BHS. But, you know, Sweet Adeline's people, I started to reach out and I'm like, why aren't other people experiencing this? And then I got like mad. I started becoming like an angry trans person. I'm like, what is happening? This should be different. It's more than just the sounds, because now when I listen to people singing, I hear more of them. I want to hear more of the people singing the words than just what some arranger wrote. I want to hear it living off the page, and we can't do that unless we're ourselves. We can't. It's difficult to really carry other stories unless you really get to sit, voice your own and live it. So.
Brave space is awesome. I think what the cool things about Barbershop is that we can stand on the risers next to people and don't even necessarily know what they do for a living or how they worship or anything else, and all make harmony together. But the real fellowship comes from understanding what makes each other tick a little more, and understanding folks. So want to start transitioning soon. Steve, is there anything else you want to add about why Barbershop that hasn't been covered?
Yes, one little thing. So when I was applying to be a doctoral student at the University of Kansas, one of the questions they asked me all kinds of questions, and the last one was, what if other people find out that you're a barbershopper? Which I thought was kind of funny. I'm like, am I supposed to come out as a barbershopper? Yes, that's okay. I'll talk about that. Barbershop is hard. It's hard to sing at the highest, most perfect levels, but it's also easy. And I get to experience some of the most sublime musical moments of my life singing Barbershop with beautiful people who are just regular folks. And we get to create special, powerful music. And I'm going to be a facilitator of that. And that's what I said to that panel of folks. I was like, well, no, that might have sunk my chances, but I'm happy to be a barbershopper and proud of it, and have always had that in my life. So
awesome. I'm just going to ditto everything else, the chords and the fellowship, everything else that have pulled me in. So we've talked, obviously we all love this hobby very much, but we want to shift in talking about some of the times when it's been a little harder for us, some obstacles, microaggressions or macroaggressions that have made it more difficult for us and others we perceive to be their authentic selves in this hobby. So I'm going to open it up, and what are some examples, panel, that you have experienced that have gotten in the way of that, or that you've witnessed?
I'm going to jump in on this. So the first thing that's important for me is to not necessarily shame people that didn't know they were microaggressing, because if they knew, I do trust that if people could do better or knew that they should do better, they probably would. I think most people have beautiful intent. And so even though, you know, the emotional labor for me, or for you know, many, many people, is to be the ambassador. You know, I do not represent the queer nation. However, I can be an ambassador of humanity and a human decent meter, and gently remind people of what needs to happen. A couple of things have happened in my journey, you know, coming into this in the 80s. It was a much different climate. I find that the barbershop world, I came in from, you know, being an activist, a very out gay performer on the gay scene, way out. So it was very odd, actually. My experience was, you know, why do you wear boys' clothes? Why do you have to try and be different? I mean, you know, you look, even microaggressions, like, you look so pretty when you wear makeup or grow your hair. It's like, is there something wrong with me when I don't? You know, like, what the person who is marginalized hears is the antithesis of what you said. It's the space around the actual comment that somebody might be assuming is a compliment, but that's a compliment from their lens, from their perspective. What I hear is, you mean I'm not handsome without makeup? Because maybe that's my goal. But the ones that stick, like, why are you trying to be different? And I kept asking myself, why am I trying to be different? And then it dawned on me, am I trying to be different? No, actually, I'm just being who I am, and it happens to be different than that status quo norm. So in addressing that, and then, you know, don't get off your soapbox. I've heard that, like, everybody knows that you're gay. You don't need to tell people. And I kept thinking to myself, I don't tell people because I don't know myself. I tell them because, you know, unlike being a person of color, or a person with any other, you know, non-status quo differentiation to them, as a queer person, you find yourself having to come out every time you meet somebody, because it's not something that is signaled traditionally. I mean, you know, the sensible shoes should have been a giveaway, but no, sometimes people just can't get that. They just don't understand, you know? Other than that, just how do you educate people when you also stand yourself to be sitting in a position where you have to defend why you're mentioning it all the time? But what I found to be very effective is to tell one person that loves to gossip, and they'll tell everybody for you, you see, and then they can walk around you if they have a problem, and you don't have to do the emotional labor of sorting that out after you become friends and become disappointed because they want to lecture you about who you should be. So that was, that's one of my tactics. But no, I decided that what I was going to do, every time somebody talked about their husband, their boyfriend, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, I would mention my girlfriend or being gay. Every time they referred to anything that would indicate that they were straight, I would refer to something that would indicate that I was not. And I never once have said to somebody, why do you talk about being straight all the time? Get off your soapbox. We know you're straight. I've never had to have that conversation, but I have definitely been on the receiving end of many of those, right to the point of, don't dress that way, you'll never get on the faculty. Don't do this, you'll never succeed at this. Don't do that, you can't do that on stage. Do you wear nose ring on stage? Oh my God, you know, you're gonna wear a bow tie on stage? Like, really? Like, and I'm talking like recent history even. So we've created inside Barbershop this other weird conservatism that doesn't actually exist in the world, it seems, we're learning. We're learning because we're having these conversations. And I found, as a gay person, we have to have tolerance, love, and definitely a sense of humor for people as they stumble along their way, because, you know, their world is getting rocked too. You know, I walked in here going, why do you all look so weird? But I didn't actually say that to anybody. My mother, better than that. But, you know, we're
it's
learning.
My mom's fault, Mo.
What's that?
So it's my mom's fault. That's why I look weird. And all right,
Alex, what are some obstacles that you've experienced?
Thanks, Terry. As I said earlier, I feel like I've probably had a pretty lucky time in all of this. That doesn't mean that I haven't experienced microaggressions every day of my life, but I feel like I've been able to manage those in a very different way. In the barbershop world, I guess The hardest thing for me was to know whether it was okay for me to talk about my male partner when talking to a group of people. And, you know, even the fact that I just said the hardest thing is working out whether I can talk about it means that that's a pretty average experience. You know, questioning whether you can talk about the person you love and live with is hard. Because as Mo said, everyone else gets to talk about it. Why can't I? So I guess that was always an element of integrating into this community that I was unsure of whether I could bring up. And I think the more queer people I met and the more there was queer representation, the more I felt comfortable about doing so. You know, little things like, signing up to something and it's saying wife on the sign up form for you to put the name of your partner. And it's like, okay, cool. That's not me. So what do? I tell them I have to change this? And, you know, so tiny little things like a form that you have to fill out is for me, the microaggressions that really start to chip away at me more than anything else, because it shows that a document has been created that doesn't include a lot of people. And that's kind of difficult to stomach, I think, sometimes. So I think those microaggressions have definitely come through in written form just as much as they've come through in spoken form. But, you know, I've had the classic, you know, why do you have to be so boisterous and big and loud and everything? And, you know, I've got to remind them that that's just part of my personality. It doesn't necessarily mean because I'm queer. Although I think those two are very much interlinked. I've definitely been told to cool it down sometimes. And I'm like, okay, I kind of get that. But at the same time, the way that I work, the way that I operate, the way that I get excited about things is intrinsically linked to what I'm doing. So if I'm getting excited and loud and big and boisterous, it's because I love what I'm doing and I can see that other people are as well. So I'm not necessarily going to want to tone that down because it would really change who I am as a person, as an educator, as a musician. And I guess the final one would be the scoffs, the side eyes, the glances that people give you that they don't realize other people might see. Just a rolling of the eyes when you talk about the queer community, or a look away, or a cough, or a shuffle, or a sidestep. I mean, I know a lot of people are still very uncomfortable about talking about the queer community and about the place that we all have in this world. And that's fine, you know, we all learn. But it doesn't mean that all those microaggressions don't still exist in a very real way for this community. However, I would back that up by saying that the progression I've seen of society as a whole is quite beautiful. And the acceptance that I think I'm seeing from so many people in generations where I never thought that would be an option is definitely changing, and quite rapidly at the moment. So that's a kind of exciting place to be.
Great. Thank you, Alex. Mia, what are some microaggressions or obstacles have you experienced?
Well, you're talking about that form. My gender is not even on the form. but we'll get to that in a bit, I'm sure. But just seeing it was just like, okay, cool. Like, what do I do now? Again, referencing my blog post from earlier, just like I found myself in the position of I sing in an otherwise male identified quartet and an otherwise female identified chorus. Now what? Just like these kind of trying to figure out, like, I have learned to take a lot of pride and fun in my costuming, but because I have all this freedom and we have amazing costumes. But at the same time, it's like, you know, once I leave the Gotham bubble, it's usually where I find myself already like on edge, because, you know, I wear a binder and a bow tie, and that doesn't usually happen in spaces that are coded for women. So we're finally getting that to change. But like, you know, when I first came over here and I heard that there even was a rainbow room, and I'm like, what? Why do we have this? Like, how did I not know? And I was so excited to like actually finally go, because I only just registered for BHS in December, having like we made the decision to compete, and that's why I'm like, yeah, time to do it. It's thinking about those things. It's being on a Zoom call with people that I want to work with in to serve, and having a comment come up like, well, I was in one of the orphan boys in Oliver in school, so I was trans before you. And I'm like, that's not how this works. But it's all the moments that, for all the times at this point that I am in a space that isn't built for me, I'm never alone. I have people who regularly correct my pronouns when people misgender me. I have people that are constantly thinking about language to make sure that it reflects all of us and not just most of us. But it's difficult to still hear the stories of people who are like, yeah, like, I wish my chorus was like yours because I told them this is what I needed and they said no. And they said, leave. That's not okay. That's not okay, people. If you're in that position, to hear your members being authentic and telling you what they need to just feel valid as a member, and you tell them no. Did you even hear them? Do you know what that's like? Do you know what it's like to be asked to leave? Because a lot of trans, I knew I was gonna cry. It was gonna happen eventually. But it hurts to know that people could be forced out of this thing we love. And that we're finally doing something about it now, and I'm glad. But I shouldn't have had to take this long. No. We shouldn't be experiencing pain doing things that we love with the people that we love, seeing music that we love. I think that what we do not just allows us to change our audience, but I think it really has a transformative effect on ourselves, and we have to be ready to like grow with that. And it's hard to be in a space where I just get that. That's like, there's no price of admission for me in Gotham. I don't have that problem here, and I need to make sure that we make it so that we don't have that problem anywhere.
Awesome.
Woo, here you go.
Thank you for your vulnerability and for sharing that. That was very powerful. I'm going to add something myself, and then if there's something else you wanted to add to it, to come back in. Mine's more of, I never knew quite how to say it, assumption of not being there. And this mostly comes from 20 years ago when comments are made in the room, and not even negative, but the assumption that there aren't any gay people in the room. Even the comics that would, great quartets that would do bits with feminine characters and everyone would laugh at. And if they did that in front of me today, I would laugh with them and that would be funny. But sitting in an audience as a gay person wondering, thinking, the people around me assume there aren't any gay people here, so they're kind of laughing at me. I had an experience, I was teaching a leadership academy, or a COTS back in the day, down south somewhere, I think it was Dixie District, and we were at lunch and I was sitting with people I didn't know mingling, and they had sweet tea and non-sweet tea on the table. And someone said, sweet, and he passed it over, and they just kind of looked at each other and they laughed, and it was clear to me it was a microaggression about, well, you better not be sweet. And I'm sure if they'd known I was there, they wouldn't have said it and they wouldn't have felt it, but it really stuck with me. I know there are lots of people in large cities, and lots of places and lots of courses, it's very open. There are lots of people that are still don't feel comfortable coming out as who they are in the chorus. And just be aware that there are people around, in whatever group you're in, there are probably people out there that are different than you assume they are. And keep that in mind. Mia, was there any more you wanted to?
Oh, something that in what you just said reminded me of like my St. Louis experience. Like we had showed up, we competed, it was great. I had a medal around my neck. I went to the bathroom. People looked me up and down like maybe you don't belong here. And I'm like, you know what? I'm feeling too good to care about this. So I'm just going to go. And you know, I had another experience like that later, but instead of feeling elated, I had just felt like things were really heavy and I needed to just take some time to myself, because it had been several days at that point of being in a really female coded space. And like, even though I was surrounded by my chorus, like it was still just a little bit much at that point. So I made a really good time, a well-timed move to like go back to my hotel room and just freshen up and take a breather. Somebody reached out to me being like, are you okay? And I'm like, yeah, I'm okay. Are you okay? And I was asked if I had seen the quartet performance that had just made a joke, something, oh, I used to sing this part, now I sing this part, I'm transsexual. And like, I'm not gonna, like, again, I assume everybody had good intentions. Like nobody wants to hurt anybody. but it was just one of those moments where I'm just like, I'm really glad I wasn't in the room for that one, because I would have probably just run out of the room crying. Apparently I'm a crier. But like, it's one of those things where it's just like, wow, it's clear that I am unseen, and that people wouldn't think that that would hurt somebody. And I don't know. I'm glad that we're finally talking about things, that we've been talking about things for a little bit, so that we can discuss how that could be hurtful without anybody meaning it to be. And I think that's where a lot more of the change is going to occur, is just being like, okay, like I'm my favorite part of tonight, actually, I'm looking forward to the Q&A. That's my meat and potatoes right there. Because I think it's important not just to be seen, but to like have this dialogue, like being able to have these conversations, or, you know, when somebody's able to have the knowledge as an ally and be like, no, they're cool. They went to the store. It's, you know, their unicorn sitting on their lap or whatever. Like, it's like, pick your small sentence to just show them how to implement the change. And that's where it happens. Because if an ally says it, it's easier than me having to constantly advocate for myself. And that's the kind of culture we need to create, where we take care of each other.
All right. On that note, I'll make another.
Jump in for a second. Sure. I just want to say something to you and what Mia said as well. Now, having said that, if I say, you know, transsectional, it's different than if somebody who's not in their community says it's this sort of like, there's a way that we can play with, like, I can call myself a dyke. I can call a friend of mine who's a dyke, but if you're not a gay woman, and in that inner circle, you can't really do that without me like raising an eyebrow and going, ah, that's too familiar. Like, there are certain language that we can use with one another, and we get it, you know, but that's our language. That's our language to use. And it's really super, super difficult for people who feel like they're trying to be supportive to try and use that kind of language, and they think they're being supportive, but if they don't have the ownership of it, I mean, but then how do you define ownership? How do we know, so there's a lot of sensitivity around how we use some of the inside terminology that we use.
And we probably don't have all the same levels of sensitivity we have. We don't represent, but it's okay to make mistakes. If you're wondering whether you're being, you know, ask one of us.
Yeah, I always assume that's
we'll help you. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I want to make the transition. We are a little behind the time, but I thought the obstacles portion was probably the meat and where we needed to spend the time. We wanted to spend a little bit of time on the transitioning voice, with everyone in harmony and mixed choruses and many ways more openness in society for transgendered people singing. More choruses are dealing with wanting to support the transitioning voice, but don't know how. So I'd like Steve Scott, and we'll get some from Alex as well, is your experience with supporting people that have a transitioning voice.
Sure, there are a few things to consider. Number one thing, I think, at least speaking personally, as a voice teacher gaining experience in my craft, I think the very first thing I was afraid of was teaching a girl. I knew my voice, and I had sung Barbershop my whole life, and so I was pretty comfortable with the male voice. But then this young lady signed up for voice lessons with me, and I was like, well, I don't know what to do. And it was scary that first time. But then I realized it's just a voice. Their passaggio is just slightly different than mine, but I know where that is because I've read the text. And after that, it was fine, because she had tongue tension, and tongue tension is universal. Everybody has tongue tension of some kind. And that's kind of been my thought, no matter what the person's background is, what they look like, how they present, whatever's going on with them, I listen to the voice. And so a lot of folks, particularly in the barbershop circles, I know when the Barbershop Harmony Society first announced everyone in harmony, and even though it's been several decades, people would say stuff like, well, can girls sing barbershop? And that doesn't even imply all the other folks on the on the gender spectrum, yes, they can. And then, but girls don't ring like boys can ring. And yeah, sorry, Mia, you're out. There's always that question. And so I say categorically, men and women and everybody in between and outside of that, none of us in Barbershop actually ring. We don't do that in our style. That's not part of our style. Ringing chords is a euphemism. What that actually means is that we're singing in tune and we're singing with matched vowels. That's what we call expanded sound. But we just use lock and ring as this kind of universal thing for Barbershop. But we don't actually, in a physiological sense or an acoustic sense, ring. If we do, it's rarely and it's momentary. So men, women, anybody singing in any style, that's not something that we do. So just take that off the table in terms of, hey, can so-and-so do this? The answer is, yeah, we can all sing. We all have tongues, we all have larynges. And if you're making speaking sounds, you can make singing sounds as well. So that's one thing that I think I need to say first about physiology. That's, we're all singers here, and we all can expand the overtone series at the same capacity. Other than that, there are a couple of things that somebody might consider as they're teaching voices that are transitioning, whether from male to female or female to male or somewhere in between. There's some specific language around that as well. It depends on if somebody is seeking to do hormone replacement therapy. That's not even the correct term anymore. Sorry about that. Help me. That's not the right word. That are taking hormones. That there are some things that happen physiologically with that. So there are folks that choose to do bindings. That's certainly a consideration to go under. But the probably the same consideration as though that were Spanx, right? So not too much in difficulty there. So I guess the thing that I want to say is that physiologically, we're all singers, we all have larynges, we all produce tone the same way. There are slight differences in terms of where people's breaks or passaggi are, but that's different from male tenor to female tenor to male baritone to female baritone. So just because I present a certain way doesn't, that's always going to be where your break is. So you just have to get to know the person and understand their voice from an acoustic perspective. surprise me. I know that this seems like it's super obvious, but it isn't to a lot of folks. Okay, cool. So yeah. I'm happy to be on this panel to say those things specifically, that it, you just have to get to know the voice. One small thing, if they are taking hormones, there can be a period of 6 months to 2 years before a voice kind of figures itself out. So if you're one that is transitioning and you're taking hormones, don't give up on yourself. And don't let us give up on you. We're here for you. We're here for your voice, however it presents itself, as long as it presents itself. So let us be a place for your voice to figure itself out.
Awesome. Alex, I know you do a lot of voice teaching and coaching as well. Do you have any other thoughts on that you want to add?
Yeah, just really quickly from a cultural point of view, I just wanted to touch on the ideas around making a safe space for those who are transitioning and those who are transgender. Just a couple of really quick and easy pointers it kind of ties right to what Steve said around dealing with voices. You are dealing with voices, you're dealing with voice parts, you're not dealing with genders. So when talking about sections of your ensembles or voice parts, it has nothing to do with gender. It has everything to do with where the voices are placed. And if the voices are placed in a place that makes them sing out and feel proud and beautiful, they're going to do the same thing for the sound of the ensemble. So it really doesn't have anything to do with gender. It's about where our voices can contribute the best. And I think it's important to remember when placing singers that's the core aspect of it. I think it's also really important to remember, and Mia may talk a little bit about more of this in a second, in that person who is transitioning or is transgender, their voice is often the biggest tell around their transition and I guess their coming out. It's also a really personal thing for all of us, the voice, and even more so for someone who's experiencing changing their voice outside of puberty. So it's I think it's really important for us all to remember how personal our own voice is, and then add on top of that a transition, which changes things completely fundamentally for someone. So just bear that in mind whenever you're dealing with singers, and remember that gender doesn't really have to come into play to it at all. Also remembering that a transition looks very different for many people. Sometimes you may not notice or a physical or hear a physical change to someone. That doesn't mean they've undergone a very radical transition for them spiritually and emotionally, but also physically. So that's another thing to consider. Regardless, for me, the gender doesn't matter. It's about where someone's beautiful voice can make the biggest impact for them and for the ensemble.
Awesome. Yes, Steve?
Let me just follow that up to Alex's excellent response. Yes. Actually, this is a pretty common question. Like, I sang in a mixed quartet, who should be singing which part or whatever. You just have to find the right repertoire. So find your right voice. I mean, my voice, I know specifically what it can and can't do. So should I be singing tenor? Only if I have the right voices singing around me. Should I be singing bass? Most of the time not. Sorry. But there will be certain circumstances where my voice will be the right voice for that song in that ensemble. So just find the group of voices that you like singing with the best, and you just have to make it fit.
And should have nothing
have to allow it fit.
Yeah, nothing to do with the person's gender identity.
Yeah, your biology. That's right.
Just really quickly to follow that up.
Discover your voice.
The BHS now has a published list of ranges for their mixed and other arrangements. And it's a really comprehensive range scale, which is a great way of working out where any voice could be placed. And that's purely based on range and comfort. It's not based on anything else. So they're great little tools to use from the BHS. Sorry, Mia.
Yeah, that's fine. I love everything that's been said. Especially like there's a lot about HRT that I don't know. I didn't even know that there may be another term that's better than HRT.
And
have to look into that.
Remind everyone, HRT stands for
Hormone replacement therapy.
Thank you.
I don't know if there's like a more affirming term, like instead of certain other words that you might use for surgery, like gender reassignment surgery. You don't say it anymore. It's gender affirmation surgery. Blah, blah, blah. So I don't know if there's any other terminology. I do know that like my natural speaking voice is lower than is what is physically comfortable or healthy. I have to really consciously think to make my voice sound higher when I'm talking. So I should be like talking up here because I actually have a range that goes up pretty high, even though I sing bass and sirens. But to that extent, like, you know, in my quartet, we've changed parts more times than I can count. We've probably tried every permutation at this point. If we haven't, like, let's get on it, guys. But you know, it really does make a difference when you just find what's the best arrangement for your ensemble. Like, you know, in sirens, we do a very specific voice placement where like, you know, every time we add a new member, we all line up, we all like fit, we figure out where that person fits and where they belong, regardless of, you know, anything else. It's just, this is what you sound like and where you will shine the best in this sound that we are all a part of. So I think those are things that are more important. Like, you know, I have people sometimes asking me, particularly as it pertains to, you know, transmasculine people in Sweet Adelines is a topic I spend a lot of time with. And people have concerns about like, oh, well, you know, if somebody's taking testosterone, isn't this like an advantage to them? Like, and I'm like, no. I mean, does menopause or like, you know, some other medical condition give you an advantage in some way because you can now sing and low? That's not how this works. And also that's not like anybody's goal whatsoever. Like, can I just please dispel that myth? We just want to have a place to sing. And like anybody else, like wherever your voice fits is where you should be singing. You know, none of that matters. I can't even find the words that grasp the like why of in my head. We're here to sing and do it together. So just find where your voice fits. And if it doesn't fit, go find three other people and sing a tag and try that configuration, or like, you know, switch parts around. We're here to do this thing we love. Stop making it hard. But also awesome. To that extent, like, you know, value everybody and make them feel valid. It's hard to describe having both of them at the same time, but they're just equally simple and true, right? You can be whoever you are and it still cannot matter for the purpose of singing. But if we make it matter for other things, then singing becomes hard. Right. So let's not make it harder.
All right, so we are behind schedule. We want to cram a lot into the remaining 8 minutes. And Ashley's going to tell me if we can go a couple minutes over as we wrap things up. Quickly and succinctly, what are some things that the BHS is doing and can, well, Barbershop is doing and can be doing, and individual courses can be doing to be more inclusive and to make more inclusive environments? What are some things you're seeing or would like to see more of? Anybody? All at once.
I'd love to jump in here really quickly to say just some things that at a headquarters level that I can mention that are changing kind of with some very exciting elements here. So let me look at my notes quickly. So if you haven't heard, Member Center, which is kind of our member portal, our membership portal, it's getting an upgrade. So in the next few weeks, we're going to have a new platform, which is exciting and scary for some that aren't maybe tech savvy, but I promise you can do it. We're going to have lots of tutorials for it. But some things that are included in that, genders, male, female, third gender, non-binary, those are going to be the new options. Salutations, so how we address you as a member. Typically you'll see Mr. or Mrs. And now we've added mix, which is MX. If you haven't heard that before, that's kind of a new one for me also. So mix or MX is a gender neutral honorific for those who don't wish to be identified by gender. And let's see some other things. We've added spouse/partner as an option. Guardian is the required field for our youth participants, not parent. And just a little bit of explanation about something. So it'll be up to the chapter leaders of the genders of the people in their chorus. For example, if I am in a men's chorus and I have a trans male in that chorus, it is up to the chapter to add them to their roster. Gender is not related to the rules around the technology. So choruses and chapters can be flexible in their specific members' identity. So that at a headquarters level is very new and, you know, so progressive in just, you know, at the membership level. So I just wanted to say that really quickly from a Harmony Hall perspective before, you know, kind of going into the social elements of like, you know, what y'all can speak on. So I'll go off video again.
So there were some questions about, and I promised to go more into the Rainbow Room. I'll do very quickly, and then we can go into more of it in Q&A. The Rainbow Room started before the Rainbow Room. Gay men that showed up at Barbershop Convention would see each other in the gay bars every year, and they've kind of said, hey, why don't we have a hospitality room? So for many years, it was a place for mostly closeted people to gather and be feel comfortable, safe space to go at the Barbershop Convention. It got opened up a little more when a few top quartets, Nightlife, came to the room and brought their entourage, and a bunch of the closeted guys went scrambling to the back bedroom so they wouldn't be seen, but it was great to have them there. And then one year we just happened to have our room that was still supposed to be kind of a private place ended up next to the president's room, and quartets just started coming in to sing, and it just became a public room. And ever since then, we still have a place to go during the week at the BHS convention. But Saturday night we host a big party, and for the last many years we've had the champs and many past champs and medalists show up and have a very gay affirming environment where people can can snicker when the gender pronouns are different by the quartets or singing to someone they love and the guys croon and stuff like that and just have a good time. If for more information on that at the next VHS, which look for somebody that has a rainbow pin on. I'll turn to Ashley and Journey for what we need to wrap up.
So in closing, I will share one more time a link here. If you would like to donate, we have a $5 suggested donation. These inclusion and barbershop series are free, but we would love it if you are able to donate $5 or more to continue bringing great free content like the inclusion and barbershop series. Please feel free to donate. I put that in the chat. It's just bit.ly/BHS inclusion. That'll continue, providing funding for this and throughout this COVID era and beyond.